And welcome back to the last talk of the RC3 this year. Penny Salib with Hearables, a citizen sign open hardware project to hearing aids, hearables, and the DIY hardware and software behind it. So go ahead.
Thank you very much. Hello, Ipang already said it. My name is Peggy Seilab. I'm a computer scientist with Master of Public Policy and media artist. I'm currently working at Fraunhofer IDMT Oldenburg in the research group Personalized Hearing Systems. I want to introduce to you the Like to Hear self-adjustment open source mobile hearing aid prototype, which we developed in the citizen science project Hear How You Like to Hear from 2017 to 2020. So I give you some overview about the motivation and what we developed and the open issues. So let's start from the motivation point. And this is all about hearing loss. And when you realize that actually 17% of the population in Germany has hearing impairments. That's actually, you could say more or less, it's the whole population in the world has similar percentages. There's some sources saying like slightly different numbers, but it's more or less, you can take it for all over the world. Now in Germany, we actually privileged, we have access to hearing aids and hearing supports. But when you realize, even in Germany, about 75% wouldn't use hearing support to get a better hearing possibility. That means, I mean, this is very optimistic, but when you make a number game, for example, for Europe, and we have 740 million people living in Europe, and that means that actually 52 million people in Europe have untreated hearing impairment. That's a huge number. And even when you were living in a country like Germany and people have access to hearing aids, nearly half of them would return them after first fit. They get it from the audiologist, try it out and say, no, I don't want it. Give it back. I don't know if you do it's the same thing when you're looking for headphones. That like half of the people just give it back. But with hearing aids, it's just like this. So something is wrong with the idea of hearing aids and the way it's adjusted. So our assumption was we want to go behind what's actually wrong with that idea of hearing aids. Why do they don't meet like customers' needs? So the first thing. What we said is our assumption that adjustments in audio laboratory is for most people unsatisfactory. I mean, I have a mild to moderate hearing loss, and I tried it myself and had the same feeling. But it was now initiated this citizen science project here. You like to hear 2017 to find out is this just me or everybody thinking like this? So I took this format from sound art, sound works, like actively listening to surrounding sounds. And we had this hearing aid, mobile hearing aid prototype with some intuitive GUI for interaction. So people could easily adjust surrounding sound. And we made these sound works. People were adjusting the sound in the ways like they like to. And we got about 1 hour locked data of people's behavior. And we did also ask people what do you like from hearables, what do you want from a hearing aid, and we got 550 submissions, and we made two hackathons. Actually, the first ones done at Fraunhofer IDMT, and about 200 people took part. So, if you're interested to get more about this project behind, you can look at this webpage, and. Yeah, actually, it was the first citizen science project, the first open source project, and the first hackathons running at Fraunhofer IDMT Oldenburg, and it was quite a new format for science, and it was very experimental and very actually exciting to go like out of laboratory and go into sort of like real life situations. And what we did, we took like more or less three sound situations, one on streets, other ones like in cafes with a lot of bubble, and other, and also going around with in parks and just let people, like we had this mobile hearing aid prototype with some headphones and let people just adjust in the sound like they wanted to, without making audiogram, without measurements, and people with hearing problems, people without hearing problems, all age, gender, everything, just let people adjust and see what comes out. Is there any like something advantage just to give the adjustment of hearing aid prototype in the hand of the people and not to the like algorithm or to audiologists? And one citizen scientist who's still active and actually using the hearing aid prototype in everyday life is Dr. Udo Spiegel, who has a severe hearing loss and had really big problems in normal life to communicate at all. He gave me this video message that I want to play now. Hopefully it works. Here we are.
Mein Name ist Dr. Udo Spiegel. Ich bin von Beruf Ingenieur. In meinem Arbeitsleben habe ich einige technische Entwicklungen geleitet und dann im jetzigen Rentenalter auch noch weiter an technischen Lösungen getüftelt. Leider musste ich damit aufhören, wegen zu schlechter Kommunikation mit meinen Partnern. Meine Hörgeräte, Akustiker, haben sich große Mühe gegeben und auch viel Geduld gezeigt bei der Suche nach einem passenden Hörgerät und bei den richtigen Einstellungen an Klang und Sprachverstehen. Leider war das alles ohne Erfolg. Wir haben kein passendes Hörgerät gefunden, mit dem ich eine einigermaßen gute Sprachverständlichkeit erreicht hatte. Mit der Like-to-Hear-Box habe ich sehr gute Erfahrungen. Das erste war, dass ein gutes Sprachverstehen vorhanden war. Und besonders beeindruckend war die natürliche Sprache der Gesprächspartner. Ich habe also eine Kommunikationsmöglichkeit, wie ich sie lange nicht mehr erlebt habe. Vielen Dank an das Fraunhofer-Institut und die beteiligten Institutionen.
Yeah, well, this shows very good the potential self-adjustment can have just by like optimizing the sound of the hearing amplification, of the sound amplification in a way it like perfectly fits to its needs. It enhances his possibilities of hearing and understanding much more. So, but I want to explain you how we made actually this hearing aid prototype. We have this like to hear framework. This is just what we developed for the citizen science project. This is actually just the control, an easy and intuitive control for the hearing aid prototype for everybody, even not like very tech interested. And then we had this basic hardware setup. We took over from the open source mobile hearing aid prototype by Professor Dr. Marc-René Schädler, who made it based on Raspberry Pi and some other modules I'm going to explain now soon. And he made also some basic adjustments to use it for, actually for him, to use it for his students, for audiology, but we could also use it for our purpose. And this, and the control itself is of the hearing aid algorithm is, the hearing aid algorithm itself is actually a processing platform of the open master hearing aid, the open MHA, which is has some the possibility of like for research and development of new hearing aid algorithms, which is also actually more like an academic platform. But I'm gonna explain this a bit better later. So about the hardware, this is actually basically the hardware you need if you want to buy and build it yourself. Need a strong battery, and about 3 ampere, otherwise wouldn't run, a Raspberry Pi and a sound card. And we used these headphones, which are quite expensive, but I think you can also use a bit cheaper ones, but not too cheap microphones, otherwise you won't be happy with it. And we have this preamplifier for the microphone signal, which is a kind of, yeah, tinkering thing. That's why we made a special for now. But all in all, it's about 200 euro, and I think you can spare a bit if you change headphones and mics. And yeah, we made this preamplifier special for now for the RC3. So we have this SMD. We made some of them and already done. And you can order this. Just get in contact to me. I have a few. I mean, I made a talk already yesterday, and I got. I think 3 are left. So if you're interested, just contact me, and I can give it to you. So it's a bit easier to get it together. You don't have to solder it yourself. So for the usage of the hardware and the software, from the user side, it looks like that you had this box and you had your smartphone. You could use as interface. You would just like log in a Raspberry Pi as an access point and call the web page, and the web page will give you the possibility to control the sound. I'm gonna explain this soon. And the sound control will be processed by the Raspberry Pi, and the changed sound then will be sent out by the headphones to the headphones. And we made also some logging of the surrounding audio, and also the presets the people would choose, so we could have a look afterwards if there are any patterns of how, in certain situations, how people react on sounds and what kind of presets they would choose. We had some very interesting and inspiring ideas out of this, but I don't want to go too deep into this in this talk. If you are interested for the data analysis, just get in contact with me. So for the control, to explain it how it works, it's really very simple. You had this like circle, and you look to the right. It would be the control page you would get, and if you would go up with the circle, you would have more volume, and it would get louder. And you go down, it would all over again would go softer. And for the X-axis, you have a sound balance. You know, I mean, if you go to the right, you would have a brighter sound. If the more you go to the left, you would have duller sound. So it's very easy. And by every single point of this GUI, graphical user interface, will have a certain sound setting. I can explain this later to you. And so basically, for the web page, we had this landing page, and then you would like fill in a user ID and start. You have this submit button, and then you have beside of the control, you could have reset for resetting, recalling the app, and also an on-off button for amplification. And we had this control GS, which is a simple Java class for control and WebSocket communication. So for the objectives of the self-fitting control, it should be like nothing special, like common Python models, plain HTML and JavaScript, easy to understand if you want to like reprogram it, understand how it works. It should be independent of third-party competence and open source for the participation of citizens. So to look a bit into the software, it's actually this like to here controlling framework and interaction framework, and which would control the hearing aid prototype. You know, you remember this is like where the hearing aid algorithms are implemented on Raspberry Pi, and that means that there was done some hardware calibration and this software set up that it would run on Raspberry Pi, and some basic OpenMHA configuration with dynamic sound compression and feedback reduction. That's all what we used for now. OpenMHA itself has much more possibilities, but actually, it's a basic hearing aid, has basic hearing aid features, and is, like I mentioned before, a research platform for novel algorithms, and provides this TCP/IP interface. It made us possible to make the web app, and it's once you get behind it, it's quite easy to configure and to run on Raspberry Pi. But you could also run it on any other like Linux system. You have the connection to ALSA and the transfer audio between the application by the Check Audio Connection Kit. So this is basically the architecture, and then to go a bit into the amplification we use, it's just very simple amplification over all frequency bands. So when you would take the circle more to the left side, it would just like linear amplification in same amount over all frequencies. And if you go more to the right, that would be would mean you would have more amplification on the higher frequencies. This is about the sound balance. And if you look for the overall gain, it's like when you put the circle up and down, the y-axis, then you would see that you have, the more you go up, the more amplification you have, but in the more, like, let's say, more volume at a certain point, you wouldn't put so much amplification on it because it would get too loud. And that is why this knee point you see. And so it's a grid of 10 to 10 presets. You automatically adjust then actually the overall frequency amplifications. And like I mentioned, x-axis is sound balance, y-axis is overall gain, and you have a bit of compression of high input levels. And for the frequencies, the processing was about 9 bands, and the audio, we did also the audio logging, it was about 6 bands. The presets were based on 2 channels, but we put actually the same amplification on the 2 of it as sort of like mono and 9 bands, and we had gain presets for 65 different input levels. And yeah, a bit of compression and a step size of 2 for minimum input gain of 0. To get a bit into the in software, we used this Python modules and had this main who is in connection with the user interface, and this would put the information of the user interface to the control, like via control Python script, which would take the presets out of a lookup table, the gains JSON on one side, on the other side log the presets and the audio level analysis to with JSON logger Python, and would also control the OpenMHA, the processing chain of the sound amplification. So yeah, if you look a bit, you see it's actually basically the same thing here. The main is in connection with the server. Oh, yeah, with the server socket, and would also communicate with a control script, and then do the JSON, the logging handling. So that's basically how it works. And yeah, the socket, we have a socket, the control JS for the socket and web WebSocket interaction, and we had a sound former for controlling 2D interface elements, and the menu for handling of the switch and reset you saw before on the user interface. Yeah, this is how it looks like. In the JSON we're logging, we have the state we're logging, we have we will see if there was a reset and the on-off, and then like the where the circle, like the preset position of the circle was set. So that's basically the state of the art at the moment. And so what's our next step? Let's listen to the next citizen science who took part at the project. And he's going to give us some inspiration. Looking to let it run.
Hello, my name is Jorge Curici. I came from Brazil, and I have a medium hearing loss, and also living in Berlin without a public health insurance, only private one, so I cannot afford a hearing aid kit. I took a part of Light to Hear project, testing the prototype for about like 10 days, and I just experiment some situations. For example, giving a class for one person in a closed place, pretty quiet. It was really, really helpful. I could understand, even like the person was not like the good distance, but normally I didn't hear. But for example, in a place for example, like a bar with a lot of people talking, a lot of noises and different distance, it was quite difficult to understand when the person was talking to me directly. And I think a smaller prototype, like a smaller version, will be really, I mean, like physically speaking, it would be really helpful for me, because like to carry like the big box, and also like with the wires of the headphones, it's not like so practical. So that's okay. Thank you. Bye.
So yeah, there's some open issues, and I actually want to call for support. It would be cool, like he mentioned, that it would just be a bit smaller, and we could even even smaller Raspberry Pis, or you could use microcontroller. So we have also some ideas to make the microphone preamplifier a bit smaller. We had a 3D case, but need some adaption. But you can find the STL file on GitHub if you like to. And yeah, it would be also more economic and better hearing when you use true wireless headphones. So anybody who wants to try it out, just let me know what your experience is. And yeah, for the web interface update, it's necessary to it would be good to have an update of the open of the operating system to Raspbian Buster, and better more robust browser communication. And this is like some basic things, and it's not so much work to do. And there's some other things like nice to have, more expert mode of adjustment enhancement, and a bit better noch sound suppression. And what would be really cool would be more feasible sound processing in real time. And for example, by Faust programming language. But if you're interested, just have a look at the GitHub repository and you find more information. I can give you some hints for cool papers. So like the first one is more or less like benchmarking with some actual hearables who have these features integrated. And and the next one showing something about over-the-counter hearing aids, which are like made for self-adjusting with audiologists. And the last one is actually saying where our idea of this 2D touch interface is coming from. It's actually my group, my colleagues, and the Fraunhofer IDMT. So thank you very much for listening. If you want to support, get in contact with me. And we have also some social media on accounts on Twitter and Instagram. You can follow if you want to keep being kept updated. And yeah, thanks also for BMBF and for supporting and Fraunhofer IDMT. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Peggy. There's no questions in the chat right now. Anything else you want to add to the talk?
No.
Okay. But I'll say thank you, because it's just what we're supposed to do more. Open source hardware, open source software. And if the citizens can do it themselves, why not? And maybe the cooperation between the pros and the people who need it can be better that way. Thank you very much.
Thank you too for giving the chance to make this project public.
Yeah, all the best for your further updates, and I'm sure we'll see you again sometime. And till then, yeah, check out the social media or the pages where you can find the information.